Nuclear forensics has to be considered as part of a comprehensive set of measures for detection, interception, categorization and characterization of a nuclear material. In case of an illicit seized material, after the detection of undeclared radioactivity, a graded iterative process begins. This process is described by the Model Action Plan, which was developed by the International Technical Working Group. The Model Action Plan was designed to secure international standards in the analysis of illicit nuclear material. The first step is categorization of the material. It assesses the threat posed by the material and the associated risk for first responders, law enforcement, personnel and the public. This step may lead to the first hypothesis. This is followed by the characterization of the material. The characterization of the material is a more thorough analysis of the material to determine the nature of the radioactivity and associated non-nuclear evidence. Radiochemical, physical, and chemical analysis methods are used to characterize the material. The interpretation of the results is an iterative process, and often the first hypothesis about the origin and the intended use of the sample are rejected or adjusted due to new analytical results. A complete nuclear analysis includes more steps than the characterization of the material. For traditional forensics, analysis techniques are also carried out, potentially including DNA examination or securing of fingerprints on the seized objects and its packaging. These results also contribute to the iterative process of the determining origin, traffic route and last legal owner of the material. At the end of a complete nuclear forensic analysis, a comprehensive depiction of the context of the sample is obtained. Radiochemical laboratories are involved in the physical and chemical characterization of the nuclear material. Following the analysis plan from the ITWG, the most valuable information is obtained as early as possible, because in nuclear forensics, time is the key. Some evaluations have to be performed just after the finding. Some analysis techniques can be performed quickly, but others take longer. Accordingly, three intervals of 24 hours, 1 week and 2 months serve as guidelines to complete the various analyses. This aims to finish the complete characterization of the material within 2 months. At first, the radiological hazard of the sample has to be assessed during the first 24 hours for an estimation of the total activity and test for surface contamination for safety reasons. For this, high-resolution gamma-wave spectrometry and swipe tests are used. Although most of the heavy nuclides like uranium or plutonium are alpha emitters, this decay is often followed by a gamma emission for de-excitation of daughter nuclides. The main advantage of gamma spectrometry is that it is non-destructive and does not require extensive sample preparation. However, it is important to consider that there are also radionuclides like plutonium-242 that cannot be detected by gamma spectrometry. After estimating the radiological threat, a visual inspection of the sample should be carried out in the first 24 hours. This includes determining the physical dimensions, weight and density of the sample. In case of seized nuclear reactor fuel pellets, the manufacturer and the reactor type for the initial use can be assigned to the geometry of the pellets. The visual inspection should be well documented by photos and, if appropriate, corroborated by optical microscopy. Further analysis often requires mechanical manipulation of the sample, which results in the loss of the original morphology. For insight of the chemical composition of the sample, X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy can be used. By irradiating the sample with X-rays, electrons close to the nucleus are released from inner shells of the atoms. The resulting electron gap is filled up by an electron from higher shells. The energy of this transition is released in form of element-specific fluorescence, which can be detected. This method is only a surface analysis technique. The accuracy is rather low, however, for a quick overview of the composition it is suitable, since it is a non-destructive technique and does not require sample preparation if it is a solid and dry sample. In the following weeks, the primary results will be verified and specified. Mass spectrometry is an important tool for this purpose, as it can be used to determine not only the elemental but also the isotopic composition by considering both radioactive and stable isotopes. In mass spectrometry, ions are separated according to their mass-to-charge ratio. The separation can be done in different ways. The subsequent detection is usually performed by electron multipliers, microchannel plates or Faraday cups. Depending on the mass spectrometer used, the information obtained and the sample preparation will vary. For inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometry, the sample has to be dissolved so that a diluted solution of the sample can be atomized and ionized in the plasma. Often, a quadrupole mass analyzer is used for mass separation. By applying oscillating electric fields to the four cylindrical electrodes, only ions with a certain mass-to-charge ratio can pass the quadrupole on stable trajectories. In combination, inductively coupled plasma and quadrupole mass analyzer offer a robust tool for sensitive quantification of elementary composition as well as a precise quantification of trace elements. For a very precise determination of the isotope ratio, thermal ionization mass spectrometry is particularly suitable as it is a two-stage separation. During ionization, a separation corresponding to the ionization energy of the analytes is achieved. The sample is heated on a metal filament by an electric current until atoms of the sample are ionized and pass into the high vacuum of the sector field analyzer. There, the ions are separated by diffraction in a magnetic or electric field. The radius of the trajectory is dependent on the mass-to-charge ratio, since light ions are diffracted more than heavy ones. The elemental and isotopic composition of the sample with spatial resolution can be obtained by secondary ion mass spectrometry. For ionization, the sample is sputtered by a focused primary ion beam. Neutral, negatively and positively charged ions are ablated from the surface. The charged particles are transferred to the mass analyzer by ion optics. In a time-of-flight spectrometer, the ions receive the same acceleration at the beginning of the flight distance, so ions with a higher mass are detected later than lighter ones with the same charge. However, ions account for only 10% of the sputtered particles. This is sufficient for the main components of a sample, but if analysis of the minor components is also required, it is necessary to fall back on the 90% of the sputtered neutral particles. These have to be ionized before being transferred into the mass spectrometer. This is called secondary neutral mass spectrometry, where, for example, the neutral particles are ionized by resonant lasers. Other information can be drawn from the crystal structure of the sample. Therefore, X-ray diffraction analysis is another non-destructive analysis method that can be applied. The wavelength of X-rays roughly equal the distance of atoms in a crystal lattice. Hence, X-rays are diffracted by passing or being scattered from a lattice, giving information on the crystal structure. This brief overview of the main techniques used in nuclear forensics should give you an idea of how much knowledge is required to perform a comprehensive nuclear forensic analysis.